Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. Hopefully you can hear me properly this week. Last week's episode with Craig Berry was terrible. Not because of Craig. Craig's great. I really should put that out there. He was excellent. My microphone was not. I was like it was a very echoey. It was an echo chamber. It was. I've cleared this room out, and it's unfortunately affected the podcast, which is terrible. I should put more shit in this room. Sorry,
Craig, if you're listening to this.
So my guest, who's jumped in already, he's returning. You'll know anyway because it'll say on the bar at the start of the episode. I am joined again by the Social Blade. I think he's going by now. The aficionado of Spider-Man, all things, which we'll get into in the episode. It's Alex Webb. Welcome back.
Hello, thank you for having me again.
As soon as Frank actually started putting out Spider-Man stuff, sorry, Frank Mandolini, should say, from Last Minute Wrestling Podcast, we started putting Spider-Man stuff out there and his awful opinions about it. I was like, I know how I need to get back on the podcast.
Oof. I mean, I've heard you say some stuff about my Spider-Man opinions before, though, Billy. So, I'm sure we'll get into that.
He didn't like No Way Home. So, I mean, it's his opinion. That's the end of the day. It's wrestling. It's movies. It's everything. You can like what you like. Doesn't mean I have to like it.
That's fair enough.
But I'm not gonna say you're wrong. Even though he was. Anyway, right. So we're going to do the wrestling stuff, though, because this is a wrestling podcast. We're not going to make it all about Spider-Man, because we might get into other stuff like Morbius and all that kind of...
Oh, please, please don't. Please don't.
Oh, now we are. Definitely going to get into
Morbius. Oh, great.
But we're going to talk about wrestling. So it's been about, when was it? March 2021 was when our episode went out, the first one. So yeah. I think must have recorded it February, something like that. So must
yeah, about that, because it was just before my birthday, I think, I'm pretty sure.
So we've come up to about a year since we last had a chat, and at that time, fuck all was happening. There was no wrestling. Yeah. Everything was over. But since then, wrestling has come back. So that's always good. So we'll start with your comeback match, which I haven't written down in order, so I'm going to panic and go Discovery.
Yeah.
Yes. Right, so Discovery Wrestling, your first match back, then you're against the 9-9.
Uh-huh.
2 for 2. So this is your first match back.
Billy, you reviewed the match.
I know, but I don't remember these things. So it's,
honestly.
I didn't know it was that or reckless. So I was kind of like trying to just take a stab.
No, it was Discovery, because I remember I was shitting myself for that match.
Well, that's what I was about to ask. So it's First Saints, 9-9. Discovery Wrestling's first show back, so there's a lot of hype about it because Discovery is one of the biggest companies in the country. Yeah. And, you know, you've just got a match that could mean that you're going to become a tag team champion, or at least you're in the first step on that road to be tag team champion.
Taking it step by step.
It was actually really, like, from what I remember, now I know I wrote about it, now I've got to remember what I wrote. I enjoyed the match, if I remember rightly. So what were your thoughts on it?
I think going, like, I've wrestled Jack and Dickie before. I wrestled Dickie separately, and I wrestled 9-9 in tag team match before the big impending lockdown happened. So I remember coming back into 2021 and knowing I'd be on the Discovery show and being like, knowing I'd be in this match in the first round of the tag team tournament. I was like, fuck, this is my first match back. I'm also very happy, I can swear, because it just comes out naturally. But I was like really, really scared. Not scared. That's the wrong word to use. I was nervous. I was nervous going into it because it's been my first time in front of a crowd and wrestling again for around about 20 months at that time. And I was on the show with people that had obviously been wrestling for like ICW on the network and stuff like that. So I was like, this is my first match back. I was putting a bit of pressure on myself not to fuck up or anything like that. So I remember going to the match and we started like putting it together and I was like, oh, okay, this is fine. We got everything put together, came out into the match. Don't get me wrong, there's a few things that I did specifically where I was like, that could have been tighter, that could have been better. But overall, I really enjoyed the match and I really enjoyed being in front of Discovery because they give you as good as you give them. So it was like they were feeding off me and I was feeding off them. So it was really, really good to be in front of that crowd for my first match back.
I like you taking advantage of the swearing coming in, because like I said, I did the episode with Craig and with my terrible sound, and he didn't swear at all And I told him he could. And it was like he wasn't doing it. And I was. And I was like, am I the uncouth one here?
Oh, no. Like, on a real, I noticed it when I was doing the podcast with Franco. I was like, I swear way too much. I was like, I'm surprised I managed to get out of your one, the first one I did with you, without swearing at all.
Oh, I mean, that seems to be I've taken that rule away in season four. Everyone can swear now because, you know, who cares? It's just words. It's not like we're saying anything particularly bad about anything in particular. But no, it is weird seeing, listening to people chat to me, and then they go into like Mickey Vago's Mosh Pit episodes and they're just swearing constantly. And I'm going, oh my God, you lasted an hour not doing that with me. That is fucking impressive in itself. So yeah, Discovery Wrestling came back. Of course, I watched the match that came out on YouTube. Their other show, I'm sure, is going to be out soon, hopefully, so I can watch it, because, you know, Edinburgh is a pain in the arse to get to from all the way up.
I can imagine from all the way up in... Are you Elgin again?
Elgin, yeah.
Yeah, I can imagine it'd be difficult.
Well, you did the travel from Perth to Bucky. It's a fucking dicey road, as it is.
The car journeys were something, anyway.
You see many sites, mostly trees and fields. And
well, it was more with like the people that are in the car as well, because you get so many conflicting personalities, and I'm quite quiet in the best of situations, so I'm just kind of sitting there while people are just talking a load of shite, and I'm like, I like wrestling. That's about it, really.
You're sitting there going, oh, where are we? Aberdeen. Oh, fuck, still got another hour to go.
I'm checking Google Maps, like, okay, we're in Aberdeen. Can only be like 5 minutes until we're in Bucky. No, like another half hour.
Yeah, the very least. And then you have to go into that cold as fuck Fisherman's Hall to wrestle for 5 minutes. You know, memories.
Lovely memories.
I think you had your newspaper gear at that point. And
don't, please, I beg of you.
And your wonderful haircut as well. I think, did you have it? No, I think you might have been cutting it back at that point.
I remember in my first year, I had obviously the newspaper tights that I had before Austin Aries. He stole them from me. And I had obviously the extremely long hair. And I started to like, because people would just fucking grab me and I would be losing like strands of hair. And I'm like, lads, you can't be doing that. So I would start to cut my hair a little bit. Plus it looks a bit better. For everyday life, but yeah, no, I got a lovely reminiscent of that gear and that hair when I watched my old wrestling matches. So thank you again for reminding me of that.
All right, I loved watching that video mainly because of all the matches that were on there. I was like, how much can you actually speak about the particular surroundings of the matches? Because, you know,
oh yeah, I'm very aware that like. I'm not big on YouTube or anything in comparison to other people, I'll say. But I knew for a fact it would give that company in Dundee a bit of publicity. So I was like, I won't mention him by name, but there's only so much I can show about because their branding is plastered on fucking everything. So I was like, I'm gonna have to like show the matches, but I'm not gonna mention any particular people that I don't agree with. So I tried to get around it as best I could. I think I did well.
Were there any matches that didn't make the cut? Like ones you recorded maybe and just thought, no, that's not going anywhere near this compilation?
Not really. I specifically picked them out before I went to do the reactions with Ryan. So I was like, okay, there's this one with Zach, this one with Kenny, because that's my worst match I've ever done. One with Ian, which isn't terrible, but I think there's a lot to talk about in it. So I was like, I can do that. And obviously my debut. There's other matches there that I was like, I could have included that, but it's a bit risque. So I was like, I'll just keep it to those four. And because I can talk about them, and I know the people in those matches will take it well enough, because there'd be some people that I could talk about and do my usual style of jokes, and they might not take it so well. So I was like, those four people will be good enough to take what I was saying, because there's more taking piss out myself, but also the match itself. So I was like selective of that.
Fair enough. Is there a part two on the way, or are you just kind of build up a little bit of a backlog of matches first?
There are matches that I could do like videos on, but I was like, I'm more looking to kind of branch out and still do wrestling games as well as doing obviously all the little Spider-Man stuff and all the Marvel games as well, because that seems to be doing quite well for me at the time.
Yeah, you did not bad. I can't remember what it was when we last chatted.
I remember you asked me about this, about doing YouTube and stuff like that. And I remember at the time I said I was on 3,000 subscribers. Which?
What? So
yeah,
you're on a bit more than that now. just a bit. I mean, for comparison, I'm on 387 as of recording. Not that I keep count of all them. I know them by name and possibly by address at this point. But okay. So when was it now? 66 something?
I believe it's just past 68,000.
Right. So what number was it when you went, this is a bit mental? Was it 10?
I think it wasn't specifically the number of subscribers that I had. It was, I remember I was getting a lot more traction for my TNA video game that I did. And I was like, oh, this is getting like a lot more views than it used to. And it was piling up and piling up and people were subscribing. I was like, oh, that's really cool. I was like, so I think I got to like eight or 7K, and then I put out another video and that one got 1,000 views in an hour. And at that time for me, that was like, holy shit, that's a lot. And I just kept on piling up until I got about 50K in a day. I was like, oh shit. And then I kind of started to realize it more and more because I was getting like 5,000 subscribers a month, 10,000 subscribers a month, to now I'm at the point where I'm getting like 100K in like 2 weeks, which is mental to me. So yeah, that's where I started to I think when I posted that video is when I started to realize, oh, this could be something. So now it's my job.
that's amazing. It's quite, we're in an age where that can happen. Not only you could probably make a full-time career in UK wrestling scene, but you could also make a career off YouTube and TikTok and influencer stuff, which I clearly can't say, so I'll never become one.
I hate it. I absolutely despise it when, because my friends will take the piss and be like, oh, he's an influencer. And I'm like, please don't call me that. I think the term influencer has been, is got some really negative connotations. So I'm like, just YouTuber or content creator sounds a lot less wanky than influencer.
Yeah, absolutely. Content creator, they go, what kind of content? I don't need to know.
She's trying to explain this to like my gran or something like that, where I'm like, she's like, what do you do for a job again, Lahid? You need to go and set your CV out or whatever the fuck she'll say. And I'm like, I work online, granny. And she's like, what do you do? And I'm like, enough. I make videos on like, what kind of videos? And I'm like trying to explain to her that I do game reviews. And she's like, do people actually watch that? And I'm like, I'm as surprised about that as you are, to be honest.
It could be, I mean, not worse, but it could be like, I do OnlyFans. So not that that's a bad thing. People make their money, people pay for anything.
Oh, 100%. If you can make bank off OnlyFans, go ahead. I think specifically the idea of me doing OnlyFans though is a little bit of a funny one.
Yeah, you never know. I mean, you could be branching out. Who knows? We'll park that there.
Part three coming next year. We'll see what we've got.
That'll be Twitch hot tub streams. That's what we'll be doing next year. So let's continue the wrestling chat though. We've sidetracked very wildly into OnlyFans, so we'll go back to the wrestling. So we've got Reckless together. Yeah. So that's your home promotion.
It is indeed.
As I cringed when I listened to our first chat this morning, and when I said, "Oh, you change source now," and you went, "No, I don't." Oh, fuck. So I did my research.
To be fair, I was wrestling quite a lot of source before the pandemic, so I can get why that was like a bit of a mistake there. So you're fine, don't worry.
Right, my first lot of interviews were just terrible. I was listening to Caleb Valhalla, the first one I had with Caleb, and I could hear myself typing, and I wanted to punch myself.
Oh.
So clearly I was like checking something on Cage Match or something. I was like, yeah. I could just hear the click, 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 click while he was speaking. Like this is the, I would hate me.
You do that though at the start when you're like making stuff and you don't really know what you're doing. You learn by trial and error though, so it's good to see that. Like obviously you're doing a lot better now.
I've got a ring light, everything.
Exactly.
And I've got a microphone which I'm not sure works. So I mean, it's getting there. Yeah. So Reckless, you've got Fear City Saints against. I've got Grummy Bears here and there and everywhere.
Yeah.
Solomon Grum and Jarek Novak. I think he said his name correctly to me in our episode with him, my episode with him, but I've forgotten.
I completely forget that's his name a lot of the time. I just refer to him as Bear, and that's exactly what I'm going to continue to refer to him as.
Fair enough. So what was that like? I think I've seen GIFs of your...
Of what, me flying?
Yes.
It was fun. I like being in front of like the Reckless Intent crowd, specifically because there are people there that know you and kind of like pay attention to what's happening, or at least are there consistently, so they know who you are and they'll give you a reaction. So the people that aren't there as consistently be like, oh, he's a good guy, we'll cheer for him. But it was good just to be in front of that crowd again and having a fun match, I'll say, with Baron Grum, specifically because I know for a fact Grum can just throw me about. So I'm like, that'll be the match. So like we came into that, we put it together, and I actually really enjoyed it. I think Grum came out of that as well, really enjoying it too. So it was nice to see, and it was also good to see those lovely gifts that I got, so I can put them on Twitter. Specifically because we've done that like move many times before, and he's never got me as high. So I ran at him, I shouted Grum, he lifted me up, and I was like, oh shit, I'm very high. And then I came crashing back down to earth, and it hurt inside.
Nice, like it. So yeah, it was less dirty dancing, just more.
I mean, yeah. I don't doubt that I could easily do dirty dancing with Grum, but that's the OnlyFans content, so we'll stick to the wrestling match for the time being. But no, I enjoyed it, and I think it came together really well. Again, there's more stuff for just me specifically. Just I know my timing can be a little bit off, and I think that's just because I haven't been wrestling as consistently as I'd like to. So obviously, just getting back to the swing of things for me with a few things.
And then finally, you said like go in front of a crowd that know you. So as of recording, we're 10 days out or 11 days out from WrestleZone Summer Hill Showdown. This will go out way afterwards. So yeah. We'll say the match was fantastic. Okay. but you're making your WrestleZone debut. So again, when I listened back to our first episode, WrestleZone was on your list of companies you wanted to go to. And I was like, ah, that's quite nice that you're actually getting to go there. So you're coming in and you're against Brian Tucker.
Indeed I am.
So he's been around for quite a while. He's got some cracking tartan trousers. I don't know if you're aware of this.
I have seen his ring gear, and I'm like, I really want to just like pull his tie. See in wrestling, right? If you're wearing like on your ring gear, if you're like wearing a tie, is it fair game to like tug it or anything like that?
See, when I was watching old OSW reviews and I saw IRS kept popping up, and
yeah,
the tie. I think if you're wearing it, then no, it's fair game.
Yeah, and so my game plan is just do any Irish whip by the tie. And I am looking forward to it. It's a new crowd and it's a different place. And I think specifically, I remember I said that to you. It was on my list of places to go. I'm really looking forward to going there and showing people what I've got. And also people that, as yourself, you haven't seen me for like, what, 4 years? So it's cool to show you the different stuff that I can do now.
Yeah, I mean, of course, obviously I've watched the Discovery Wrestling stuff and that, because I watched and reviewed it, apparently. But I haven't seen you since UPW would have been the last time I saw you. So very, very long time ago. You've had new gear and everything since
I know.
Last time I saw you
wrestling. I've went from Amazon tights to my own shorts. That shows the growth there.
Yeah, so I can't wait. Like I say, this is going to come out afterwards, so we'll just. I'm not going to like edit out either way, but I'm just saying it was an excellent match, and five stars.
Thank you. And if it's not, I apologize. I'm sure it'll be fine.
I'm sure it will be. It's as long as you escape ridicule again from, like, say, Kelly or K&K podcast, you'll be fine. there's your two audiences for people to judge you.
I'll be looking out in the crowd, being like, where are they? All doing all my shit towards them just to pop them.
We'll have the notepads out, just writing down notes. I should really start doing that. I'd never remember any of the matches because I just enjoy wrestling. Let's just watch it and enjoy it, and then afterwards go, fuck, what happened? I need to remember now. One of us will remember. That's why I usually wait for Adam's review, and then I read it and go, oh, yeah.
And that's what happened.
That was the finish. Great. Anyway, that's the wrestling stuff. So let's get Spider-Man. So this is what people really been here for.
I don't know how I've given myself the kind of like, okay, no, I do, but I still don't understand how I've managed to give myself as the Spider-Man wrestling guy here, but I'll happily take it.
Say, are you fed up speaking about wrestling, about Spider-Man on wrestling podcast?
I will never be fed up as talking about Spider-Man, as you can probably tell by the beautiful aesthetic of my room here.
Very nice. I'm so concentrating looking at the camera. I wasn't even looking at your background. Very nice. Mine has just gotten poppier. So much more.
You will hate me because I take mine out of the packaging.
Well, we discussed this last time. I found the boxes for some of these, and they now have boxes again. But I do have many that are still out of the box. So
okay,
that's just the way it is. My personal favorite being this little mariachi Deadpool fella.
Oh, I like that.
Because it just reminds me of knowing the mask with Jim Carrey Cuban Pete, and he does that bit. But every time I look at it, that's all I've got in my brain, and he's not going to stay out now. There we go. Come on, Hulk. Just there we go.
For any of the audio viewers, Billy is trying to carefully put back his Deadpool pop.
Because it does not fucking stay up. That's absolute arsehole of a thing, although I love it. It's like, most of the time I had it like on top of this pile before, and near every time during the day I would shit myself during work because I'd hear this massive like bang and I'd hear this massive bang and there he was just on the floor somewhere.
I've resorted to kind of like sticking some of mine down because one's on top of my PS5 and it always falls, so I'm like, I'll try to like keep them up there as a little PS4 Spider-Man. I'm really not helping with the stereotype here, am I?
You're not, no, but it's fine. That's what we're into. So yeah, you've become the you're the Scottish wrestling Spider-Man expert that everyone calls upon now for Spider-Man opinions. So we know you love the Raimi-verse. So we're just going to kind of go back to the start a little bit and just talk about your love for the Raimi films, and then we'll talk about the Webb ones and MCU and all that.
Okay.
And we'll get some Japanese Spider-Man in there as well, because
we definitely will. My top three, honestly.
So we'll start with Raimi. So 2002 was the first one. You would have been like...
four.
Very young. Oh, God. I don't know why I asked.
I'm sorry, Billy.
Sorry. I was 12 for those keeping score. So yeah, 2002. So you wouldn't have seen it at the time. I would have been afterwards.
I specifically remember... Okay, so I was a massive fan of like the animated shows. So the animated 90s TV show, I should say. I remember really liking I think this is where, because my two like favorite characters from Marvel, and they're probably not the most like, not the most nuanced ones, don't have the best stories, but Spider-Man, Venom. I really like Spider-Man just because of his like whole relatability. Bit of a meme, but he's very relatable to people like me, always like me and pretty much everyone else, like really down on their luck. Didn't particularly fit in, but like always like has a good heart and always cares for people and shit like that. And Venom, he looks cool. So I always liked him, especially in the 90s animated show when he had the really cool like half blue, half red or orangey lighting. I just thought he looked really cool. But I remember specifically watching that and being a huge fan of it. So I remember one fateful evening, I went to Tesco's with my mother. And I've seen this live action Spider-Man DVD or video. It might have been video at the time, but I remember seeing it and being like, "Huh, that looks like this the cartoon I watch, but in real life." So I begged my poor mother to buy it, and she did. I took it home, and my life changed since then. So I bared witness to one of the best origin stories, I will say, and still one of the best superhero origin stories. When I finally seen Spider-Man 1.
So I watched it back during of course the build up to No Way Home, because I needed my Spider-Man content, because I was on edge, just shaking, need to see it. You know what, I still enjoy it. I think if you think when if it was made 2002, you have to bear that in mind. For some of it, obviously, because you know there's the
there's some inexcusable bits, because like a lot did the Lord of the Rings films not come out around about that time as well?
Oh, probably.
And if you compare like their special effects to the Spider-Man one, it's kind of night and day. Like the one that always the two that stick out in my head that being particularly bad is Peter just gets his powers, so he's like climbing up the wall and he goes woo, and then it cuts to him running across buildings, and it just looks like a rubber man jumping across a green screen. It doesn't look great. And the other one is during the, I can't remember the name of it, but it's during like the parades with all the floats. The first time Green Goblin really attacks. And it's just like Spider-Man jumping across the balloons. Yeah, it doesn't look great. Does not detract from the storytelling of the film though, because I still fucking love it.
There's, when you said the parade, I had two things in mind. Was Green Goblin flying, it just looked like it was a guy with a bit of cardboard Green Goblin just going like that on the screen, and of course when Spider-Man takes Mary Jane away, and
the mannequin. Yeah.
So, and her hair's going the wrong way.
I mean, I can't unsee that now, because I used to watch a lot of like things you didn't notice in films on like TV and shit like that. So it was like when that popped up, it was like, one, her hair's going the wrong way, and two, it's very evident it's a mannequin.
But like you say, it doesn't detract when you go into it going, I'm just wanting to see a Spider-Man film. Yeah. It's still
I think it shows like a very faithful rendition of Peter Parker's back origin story. And I also think it hits on the key themes of being Spider-Man, that being responsibility, that being the whole kind of big that being responsibility, the great power comes with responsibility and learning to live with that. And I think there's a really good dynamic in there with Norman and Peter's kind of stories kind of being quite similar. Both of them get powers. Both of them do very different things with those powers. And it comes together at the end with very conflicting moral compasses. And also Peter trying to like realize that Uncle Ben like is like his kind of like father figure in a way. And he kind of realizes that at the end of the film. Because at the start, he's like this edgy. I don't want to say edgy because he's not really edgy. He's more, I don't want to say weird as well. But he's like, he's just kind of like, not knowing his place in the world. So I think, and he says to Uncle Ben in the car, is like, well, because Uncle Ben's talking to him, he's like, I know I'm not your father. And he turns around and is like, well, stop lecturing me like you're my dad or whatever. And then Uncle Ben just looks really sad and then he dies, which is very heartbreaking. And then at the end of the film, when he's fighting Norman, Norman takes off his mask and he's like, ha ha ha, I'm the Green Goblin. And Norman's like, Peter, you are a son to me. And Peter's like, I had a father. His name was Ben Parker. And then Norman's like, Godspeed, Spider-Man. Sends a glider. Spider-Man jumps over it. Norman goes, oh, and then he's dead. The end of the film. That is the best review you're ever going to get out of me, by the way.
When I watched it back, I was like, I didn't mind the green. There was a big like furore about the Green Goblin suit, but I didn't really mind.
I think a lot of people now think of it as like kind of like a Power Rangers suit. I think at the time they couldn't have done any better, because it was still around about a time when people weren't really sure what to do with comic book films. They weren't really sure if they were going extremely campy or if they had taken like all the colorful aspects of the comics and stuff like that. So I think for what they did, it was fine. And I think it more than makes up for it with the fucking amazing fight at the end of the film with obviously Peter and Norman, because it hit, for lack of a better term, it hits hard and you can feel every punch that gets thrown, unlike kind of like modern Marvel films where it's like kind of hollow.
Yeah, so it's mostly like it's like UFC, some of the Marvel fights in the end, they're all holding each other for a really long time. It's like, come on, just fucking punch him.
Yeah.
Punch him in the face. So that Spider-Man one, there's that, that's that ticked off. So 2002, I'm trying to think of any other comic book films that were out around about that time then that.
The first X-Men film came out around about that time.
Oh yeah, and it went like, oh no, we're not doing any of that camp shit. We're wearing black suits and that's it.
The black suit one's my funniest thing, because it was like, because obviously there's a scene where Wolverine's like, do you guys just wear all this shit or whatever the fuck he says, and then Scott turns around and is like, what would you prefer, yellow jumpsuits? And I'm like, yes, I would. Please. I said that joke in Frank's one as well, so that's me recycling content again.
That's all right. I'm sure that I'm sure Frank won't mind. I mean, if he's gotten this far, tough, Frank. This is what's happening. This is what's happening. I love you, really. That was it. It was just like, no, we're not doing any of that. And then you got the other way was what, 2004, Fantastic Four, and it was just like all in. Give us all the campy shit. We're gonna just take it all.
I forgot that film ever existed. Thank you for reminding me.
That's what I'm here for. I'm here not only to remind you of your newspaper tights, I'm also here to remind you of at least I haven't talked about your testicle. I mean, we'll just move on from that. Go back to the first episode, you'll find out why. Because that took up a lot of the first episode.
Yeah, I didn't realize how long I talked about that for, when I could have just said, oh, someone landed on it got hurt, the end.
I know. Well,
I went into excruciating detail about that.
I was listening to it on 1.5 just because I hate the sound of my voice anyway, so I was just trying to rattle through it. I was going, we're still talking about this. This is a really long time. But anyway, everyone else can go back to episode one. We're not dredging that up again, even though I made a wonderful pun at the end, so you have to go listen to find that out. So one way or another, it could be too camp or not camp enough, and yeah. The Spider-Man kind of hit that kind of middle ground quite nicely, and it was a good Spider-Man film.
Yeah.
And then Spider-Man 2 came around, which is fucking impossible to find on streaming services. For reasons,
I'm sure it's on Netflix.
Nope, it's not on Netflix. It's not on Prime. It's not. It's not anywhere that
you can get it on YouTube if you're willing to pay for the masterpiece itself.
That's the thing. I wasn't, but to be honest, I have a DVD. It just means I had to like go into the cupboard and take out the first row of Blu-rays and then go find it. It's just But anyway, it's the best one. The Raimi ones. Although you'll have an opinion on the third one. But 2004 came round. It was Spider-Man 2, Doc Ock as the big baddie.
Indeed. They had so much to kind of top from Spider-Man 1. And there's interviews with Tobey Maguire being like, they had so much to top from Spider-Man 1. And like Sam Raimi went straight into writing the second one. And Tobey's like, but somehow they managed to top it. And then Spider-Man 2, probably one of my favorite films, superhero films anyway. It's a very human film and has a lot of heart to it, and a lot of it is like the first half is dedicated to seeing how shitty Peter's life is, his shitty apartment, his shitty job. He has to give pictures to Jonah Jameson that will paint him in such a negative light. He's watching his love of his life get married to an astronaut who just so happens to be JJ's son. And then last but not least, Harry hates him, but he doesn't know he hates him. He hates Spider-Man for killing his dad, which is a lot of shit to unpack. And also Aunt May's in crippling debt. So soon, so you know it's a lot of shit to unpack. And it does it in such a kind of fun and heartfelt way. And never once does Peter complain. Never once does he go, oh, my life's shit. He just gets on with it. And I think it's a very, very, very good film for that. And then obviously a lot of it after that, he doesn't want to be Spider-Man. He doesn't want to accept the responsibility that's been thrust upon him. He doesn't want to be this person that ruins his life. And then he realizes he has to be Spider-Man and accepts that responsibility. He listens to Aunt May's riveting speech and then he saves the day. I'm sure there's a lot of other stuff I could touch upon, but I just love the film.
which is very evident by a very passionate speech about the whole film.
The best promo I've ever done.
I saw a theory this morning. It's TikTok, so obviously you have to take it with a mountain of salt to go with it. But the guy that rents Peter the apartment was supposed to be Kraven the Hunter, a retired Kraven the Hunter.
I could honestly see that, because Bruce Campbell, he was in all three of the films, and he was supposed to be Mysterio in the fourth one. So you know what? Fuck it, I could fully see that, Mr. Dickovich being secretly Kraven the Hunter, just tracking down Spider-Man, taking more than his rent. First I take your rent, then I take your life.
You know what? I think we're ready. We're ready for Spider-Man 4 into the Tobyverse.
Fully fucking want that.
Of course, do as a massive Tobey Maguire. Is it just the Spider-Man films, or do you like Seabiscuit? Do you like any of his other work?
Here's the thing. I would like to just say it's just the Spider-Man films, but I actually really like a lot of his other work. I really like him in Seabiscuit. I really liked him in Brothers as well, despite some of the flaws of that film. He was in a chess film as well. The only reason I know that is because there's a meme that floats around of him is like, they took that from me, Carmine, they took it. Today was supposed to be that day. And everyone just quotes it with the release of Spider-Man 4. But I just think he's so I don't want to say memeable, but he is. And I love putting him in my videos. So that love has just kind of transformed into my career. So I'm just simultaneously linked with Tobey for that now.
Yeah, especially when you saw the press release of like all these actors. I think it was, I can't remember what it was, but anyway, the punchline is him doing press for Boss Baby. And it's all these like intricate things about their character, and it goes to Tobey Maguire and he just goes, he's a baby who's a boss.
I was looking because like Andrew was like, he had Tick Tick Boom, he had like all these other films that were coming to it, so I was like, I'll like to see what Tobey was doing. And the last and the only interview I could find was this one with the Boss Baby, and he's just sitting there, he's like, well, he's a boss, baby. And I'm like, you're a cinematic genius, Mr. Maguire.
You've enthralled that character 100%. The other one go around is it Freddie Prinze Jr. Speaking about Scooby-Doo, and it's like, it's everyone else is going, oh, this character, it's your childhood, it's everything, and he's just going, it's a talking dog. And it's like, yeah, you've got it, that's it, that's all you need to do about it. So I should have written down, obviously my grammar has gotten even better in this podcast, like things like box office and all that shit, but you know, Google's your friend.
Google. I'm sure it did very, very well. I don't particularly have the numbers off the top of my head, but it did make Sony a lot of money, so much so that they made a third one.
And they were like, fuck it, we've got all these villains, we're going to just put them all into one movie.
I see. The thing is, Sam Raimi never wanted to do Venom because he didn't understand the character. He had kind of like not aged out, but he stopped reading comics around about the time Venom got introduced because he was too busy making the Evil Dead and all that stuff. But even though Sam Raimi didn't want to do Venom, I still think he did a very good Venom in the film. The reason for that is because I said it last time, but not as articulate as I'm going to put it now. The way the symbiote moves in that film, I've went on a tangent. I'll talk about the actual film in a minute. But yeah, the way the symbiote moves in that film has so much like personality, because like every little tendril is like a little hand, and especially when it's like bonding to Peter and it's like crawling up his body and it's like this monster, because the whole thing's about revenge and forgiveness, and the symbiote embodies revenge and it's like taking over Peter to the point where where obviously Peter turns into emo Peter and hits his girlfriend, which is a little problematic, but you know, we'll look past that, Mr. Maguire. And then when he's like pulling it off, the symbiote's like latching onto him, trying to grab on like with these little arms, and it just feels so not real, but it feels so so like evil is probably the best way I can put it. It just doesn't want to let go until it's forcefully removed, and it finds Topher Grace from that 70s show, which was a weird casting. Anyway, Spider-Man 3, as we're here to discuss.
Well, Topher Grace, we talked about Venom last time, because at that point, I think I just watched the first one. I still haven't seen Let There Be Carnage, but I've saw the first one and I liked it, but I liked Venom, but I didn't like the film. That was my thing was. Topher Grace, that was a weird choice. I hadn't seen that 70s show, so this is my first time seeing Topher Grace at that time, and I was going, you look a bit weird.
I think he, like, as like a kind of like smug, sarcastic dickhead to Peter, like the opposite of him in every way, it does work. But when he gets the symbiote, he's just a little scrawny, and I don't think his characterization is the best.
Yeah, I think if we'll go back in time, should have just done Agent Venom at that point or something, just get John Manganiello back, and just because he's a fucking scary dude.
Did you say what, Agent Venom?
Yeah.
Agent Venom wasn't invented until like 2011.
Oh, okay. Well, there you go. My apologies.
So it never existed.
We could have done a take on that before it was a thing. Just had Flash Thompson as Venom.
Yeah, I think that would have, like, if they had the kind of foresight to look into the future and be like, oh yes, Flash Thompson without legs has the Venom symbiote, but he can keep it under control and he's a good guy or something to that effect. I think it would have been really cool, but. What works with Spider-Man 3 is the stuff that Sam Raimi wanted to do. And that's Sandman. Because Sandman's like, everything about him feels like more of a traditional Sam Raimi villain. With like the kind of like his backstory being he's not a bad guy, just a guy that's had some bad luck. And then his whole transformation turning into Sandman is fantastic. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the scenes with him are really good. The retcon of him killing Uncle Ben is kind of iffy, but I take it for what it is, and it adds a kind of different dynamic. Not everyone has to be linked to Peter, but I do enjoy it for that. But I do think there's a lot of stuff that really works with the film. Like, as I said, the kind of revenge and forgiveness aspect of the film really works. A lot of the Venom stuff, even though Sam Raimi didn't want to do it, really works. The Sandman stuff really works. The only thing that I have an issue with is a lot of the Harry Osborn stuff, specifically with the design of him, because he looks so fucking generic. Mm-hmm. He looks like a snowboarder, and I'm like, what's happening here? And then he gets amnesia, and I'm like, oh no, Sam, what are you doing? I think the film would have been infinitely better if you just had, instead, just cut out Topher Grace. Sorry, Topher. And if you're listening. And just have it be Harry Osborn and Sandman, have Harry like resisting the Green Goblin like formula or whatever for the majority, for like the first half of the film or whatever, and then Peter like gets the symbiote, he kills Sandman, and then Harry comes into the film finally taking it, finally falling to the visions of Norman Osborn that have been haunting him, and he confronts Pete, and then he's like, and then Peter beats him and nearly kills him or whatever, and then Peter's like, what have I done, I need to take off the symbiote. I'm pitching this to Sony later, don't worry. But and he takes it off and it finds its way to Harry, so Harry's Venom instead, and I think that just makes a bit more personal connection, rather than just having Eddie Brock kind of shoehorned in there. And then it could be at the end, you could still have Harry die or whatever you want, but you could still have him like fighting the symbiote and eventually gets it off, and then Spidey again nukes it or whatever. But anyway, my opinion on it, so many good scenes, so much good shit in it, that I think it's too good to just pass off as a bad scene, as a bad film, just because there's some aspects that aren't great, like the musical number in the jazz club. Not the dancing. Okay. Not the dancing walking down the street. I mean specifically the amnesia storyline and the big musical number in the jazz club when he's like he turns up with Gwen just to embarrass MJ, and then MJ's going to sing and he just magically appears on the piano and he's like, now tango with this. Do. And I'm like, oh. I mean, although it did make me more attracted to Tobey Maguire, so you know, there is that.
Was there a part of you when you were obviously your transformation with your hair? How far along in your brain did you go with Maguire before you thought, no, it needs to come off, or it needs to be gelled? Was that ever a thought in your mind?
Right. It was never the idea was never to be emo Peter Parker. It just kind of happened. So obviously I've kind of made it a little bit more. I'm thinning at the top, so I've done as best I can.
I get that.
I'll meet you there soon, don't worry. I can't grow a beard though, so I'm just gonna be egg eventually. Yeah. but it was never the plan, but you know, I'll take it. I just need to get the guy liner out eventually.
And just remember, do the
I'll go and grab a black suit as well, just so I can strut about Perth with it.
I'm trying to think of a street in Perth that I've ever seen, and just imagine
it's a small little city. I'll just be rocking up the high street with everyone in Starbucks looking at me being like
that's for the video
please don't give me ideas, because I have many ideas just to do it in IRL. I want to get a Tobey Maguire cutout, and I want to go traveling with the cutout specifically to take pictures with Toby in different locations, so eventually I will find the real Toby and I'll take a picture with the cardboard cow and him.
This is happening. This is your I mean, YouTube's the job, but this is the dream. That's the dream, to meet, well, obviously to meet Tobey Maguire, but
with YouTube being so what's the word I'm looking for? With YouTube allowing me to do a lot of things, I can go traveling and I can go and find Toby. That's gonna be the goal come next year. I'll just not upload for 6 months and I'll be a full documentary of finding Tobey Maguire.
Netflix, get on it. That's it. Yeah. Also put on Spider-Man 2, you dicks. That'd be great. You put on everything else but Spider-Man 2, which, you know. But yeah, that was it. It was overloaded, Spider-Man 3, but like, it's much like a wrestling show. You've picked out all the bits you liked and you found enjoyment in it.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, which sometimes you have to do when you go to wrestling. Sometimes you go to a show and go, oh, that was all shite, but that thing I liked, and that's all you need. It's all you need for a positive review.
It's like when you have a bad match, you just pick out the best points and then you make a YouTube video about it and laugh at yourself. All good.
I did a cracking Irish whip. There we go. That's the review of the show. So yeah, that was the trilogy. Supposed to be a fourth, like you say. Supposed to be Bruce Campbell's going to be in there as Mysterio. Was John Malkovich as Vulture?
Yeah, they had Felicia Hardy in there as well. That's Black Cat. I think maybe, I don't know. Potentially will be one in the future, given No Way Home. But I'm sure we'll get to that.
Oh, we absolutely will. And I think Sony is now just sitting there, just going, right, let's make some money out of this. Let's try and squeeze every last. Drop of all these spider nerds. Let's just get the films all made, which, you know, my wallet's ready. So
indeed, so is mine.
As much as I'll be like, no, I won't, I'll be still going on the View app and just going, right, when's the first showing? And just,
no, please don't take my money, Sony, please.
Oh no, it's only £4.99. Oh, it's £1 to go VIP seats. Oh no. Anyway, right. So time has passed. 2007 has been and gone. You're now still really fucking young.
2012, I would have been 14.
Well, I'm 2007. We're still at the end of...
Oh, 2007. Okay.
So I would be 17. Christ, a whole life ahead of me. I had a full head of hair. So yeah, that was it. No more Spider-Man. I don't know when the news came out that Tobey was not coming back and there wasn't going to be a fourth one, but we're now in 2012, so you're 14.
Indeed, I am. The world is supposedly ending.
Of course, yes. It's all over. And to combat that, Sony have went, you know what? We might have to give Spider-Man back to Marvel. So we're going to make another Spider-Man film. And we're going to get I don't think they really chose Mark Webb. I think he was born to do a Spider-Man film.
What, with the surname?
Yeah, pretty much. It's like, I don't think... I would bet, just because of how not great some of the films were, and might not... Probably Sony meddling. I'm going to say it's probably that. But I would guess they just went through a list of names and went, Mark Webb. That looked fucking hilarious. Let's get him in here for a Spider-Man film. So yeah, 2012 came around. Andrew Garfield... He's a liar, but he's also played a really good Spider-Man.
He's a filthy liar, but he does play a very good Spider-Man. In fact, I would go as far to say, out of those two films, he's still my favorite aspect of those films. I have taken the piss out of Andrew Garfield and those specifically those amazing Spider-Man films before. No Way Home and rewatching the first one anyway has given me a new appreciation for Andrew Garfield.
It certainly made me feel better about getting an Amazing Spider-Man tattoo. Once I watched No Way Home, I was like, oh God, you've made me not regret getting it anymore. That makes me feel so much better. Because every time I looked at it before then, I was like, you are the worst decision I made. And I've made some terrible decisions in my time, but that was pretty high up there.
I'm wanting to get before we move on to the amazing ones, I'm wanting to get the Maguire like Spider-Man symbol kind of like on my wrist or something. So I'm looking to get that at one point.
Well, hopefully by the time this goes out, no, actually not, it's May, I'm booked in, but I've now got Nurse Spider-Man since we last chatted.
Okay, sick.
Over there. And I'm planning to get like some like skin rips. But underneath is a Spider-Man suit.
Ooh, very
so,
sick.
So that'll be the bottom half of my arm finally done, which has taken me forever to do. And then the top
tattoos are, I don't blame you, man. Tattoos are one, they suck, and two, they're expensive. So I don't blame you.
Well, that was the thing. I forgot how much they suck. And I got pretty much all got these done and the front of that done during all this lockdown stuff. And I thought, oh, that'd be fine. It was a bit nippy. And then I got this bloody Lucha skull thing.
Yeah.
I wanted to die. It was so fucking sore. I was lying down the whole time and it was so sore. And then she stopped, the tattoo stopped. And I thought, that's fine, I'll be almost done. Looked over it, outline. But, oh shit, there's so much color. And that was the worst. It was like 3 to 4 hours of my life. And I still want to go back and get another one, but you know, I'll remember the pain when I get there and think, oh, fuck, why have I done this again? And why am I spending so much money on it? Anyway, so yeah.
For your passion of art.
Exactly. And yeah, for something that I'm going to have to explain to people. And it's like, listen, it's not as bad as the Hardy Boys sign. I had to explain that for so long. People thought
I read that though, because it's something unique to you as well though.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, everyone thought, oh, is it Thor's hammer? Or was it something like that? I was like, I mean, it could have been Stormbreaker, but I got this when I was 21, so it was very, I was very progressive. I knew Stormbreaker was coming eventually, 20 years later. So yeah, let's go into Mark Webb's then. 2012, Lizard was the villain in that.
Good choice.
Very bold. I did not like the design of Lizard, personally.
Oh, fuck me. He looked like, you ever seen the Super Mario Brothers film?
Yes.
You know the Goombas from that? Yeah, he looks like that. And I'm not the only one to have said that. There have been many people that have said that before me, but he I can't unsee it. Like, he's supposed to be like a lizard, but but he comes across, like, his design in the comics has always been more like alligator-esque, with like a long protruding like snout and shit like that. But he looks better that way than just having nothing there.
Like Voldemort with scales.
Yeah, just it looks so. Spider-Man is dead. Ha ha ha! I can't do the Voldemort laugh, but you get the point. But like I just don't know if they hit the design as well as they could have done. Keep him in his lab coat as well. He only wears it for like 2 seconds in the film, and he takes it off, and he's just this random scaly man running around. Also, his whole plan of turning everyone into lizards doesn't make sense. He's like, we need a better tomorrow. We need to turn everyone into lizards. And I'm like, do we need to, though?
Like, his initial plan was just to grow limbs, and then he became a lizard. So, like, I'm trying to remember the film. Was his plan always to do that? Or did
I
don't know.
I've watched the film recently because I'm doing a video on the Amazing Spider-Man game. So to refresh myself, I watched the film just to like get a few jokes and snippets and like for a backstory in the film before I talk about the game. And I was watching it, and he goes from like really wanting to get this serum to work. He tests it on a mouse, and before he can see any of the results of that test on the mouse, some like evil Oscorp guy comes in and he's like, we need this to work now because Norman Osborn's going to die. And he's like, well, I need to see the tests and whatever. And he's like, no, you need to do it now or you're fired. And I'm like, what good is that going to do? You need him to stay to make more. And he's like, so it doesn't make sense. And he injects it into himself and his arm grows. And then he's like, goes to find the Obscorp guy to stop him from canceling the research project or whatever. And then in the taxi, he turns into a lizard. And then he just tries to kill him. And then he's like, we need a better tomorrow. We need to turn everyone into lizards. And I'm like, we've missed a few steps here, lads. Yeah. Like,
I made Kelly watch it. I was forced her to watch it.
Sit here and you're going to like it.
The only one she's seen is the first Raimi one. That's the before the MCU ones. So that's the only thing she's seen Spider-Man wise. So I thought, right, I'll make you watch this. You're not going to like it, but we'll make you watch it. And she couldn't get past the new hand of Kurt Connors and how disgusting it was and how
I think that's the point, though, is it not? Like, it's his new limb that's to be fair, though, he's like, I get like the heebie-jeebies watching the heebie-jeebies, what the fuck am I saying? he gets it gives me the ick watching it, because he like pulls off this like cocoon on his arm, and then he's got like obviously this big flappy arm that's waving about. That's a bad thing to do on the camera.
Like that.
And he's like pulling it off, and I'm like, bro, does that not like hurt? Because it's like pulling off, like, I'm assuming it's like skin and shit like that or whatever. And it just looks really gross and jiggly. And then he turns into a lizard and he looks really gross and scaly. Not a good run for the lizard in this film. And then the worst thing, that the thing that I hate the most in it. Okay, I'll talk about what I actually liked, because there's a lot of good stuff in there. Specifically Andrew Garfield's performance. I think it encompasses a lot of like a youthful, more edgy, bitter Peter Parker, which I really liked. And I really like Flash Thompson in it, for as much as he's briefly shown, because he actually has character development. He starts off as a generic jock, then Peter's uncle dies and he comes up
again.
and then Peter's like grieving his uncle dying, and Flash comes up and he's like going to like give him condolences. Is that the right word to say? Condolences.
Yeah.
And then Peter like grabs him, pins him up against the locker, and he's like, bro, your uncle died. I'm really sorry that happened to you. And then at the end of the film, he's like wearing a Spider-Man t-shirt, and he's like, you're coming along, Peter, to Flash says to Peter. And it's like a really nice kind of like subtle character development that I really liked. Didn't like Lizard, though. And I didn't like the editing of the film. I know I'm fucking chaotic as shit when it comes to editing, but when you're doing a big budget film, you have so many cuts in between, because they had like in the trailers, I remember they had this like long running scene with like, or like swinging scene with Peter, where he's like swinging from building to building, and it's from his point of view. But then in the actual final film, it's so cut up and chopped up, it looks like Kevin Dunn directed it. Like, it doesn't look good.
Right, I had a joke about WWE's camera cuts and just the back of my head, ready to go, and then you made it anyway. You're absolutely right. I'm now getting flashbacks of all that kind of stuff, and yeah, it was a like it's the Venom problem. Like I'm saying, I liked Venom, I didn't like the film. I liked Spider-Man, didn't like the film.
Yeah.
And then it got even worse in 2014 because again, I still liked Spider-Man. But this was a bad film.
Yeah. It's the only Spider-Man film to have like a rotten rating on Rotten Tomatoes, or at least not a fresh one, I'm pretty sure.
It earned it.
Yeah. What do I say about The Amazing Spider-Man 2? That hasn't already been said. Electric eels fixing Jamie Foxx's gap in between his teeth. If I knew that, I would jump into a bat. There's so much stuff that I didn't really like with it. But there are some beautiful moments in it. There are some really poignant moments in it, especially with like Gwen dying, for one. Like, that's a really poignant and sad scene. But then the rest of the film doesn't do it justice, especially Dame DeHaan's Green Goblin, where he's just, you see that look that Billy's just done on the camera right now. If you're watching it via, if you're listening to this, Billy just looked down in disappointment. Dame DeHaan's Green Goblin is such a disappointment, because he has this like big transformation scene at the end of the film where he's like turning into the Green Goblin and his like spine's like rearranging or whatever, and it looks creepy as shit. And then he shows up just looking like a severe meth user. Like, it looks like he wouldn't be out of place in an extra on Breaking Bad. Like, it just looks horrendous. And he's just shoved in for no reason. I'm just like, why is he there? And then because the film knows he's just shoved in without any backstory, they spend the first half of the film trying to establish that, oh no, Peter knows him. They're like best friends, but he was never mentioned in the first film. Ignore that. I'm like, my God, man.
What is Sony's issue with seeing a film make loads of money and go, right, fuck it, we're going to do a sequel. And you know what we need? Everyone. We'll just get everyone in here and just it a thing.
I think Avi Arad is one of the biggest reasons for these films having too much shit in them. He was the reason that Sam Raimi, if you don't know who Avi Arad is, he's like, I don't know his exact title, but he has a lot of influence and a lot of say in what happens in a lot of Spider-Man films. And he's like, and to Sam Raimi, he was like, Sam, you're missing Venom. The fans want Venom. Think about the toys. So he was like forcing Sam to do that. And I think with this, it was kind of the same. Not, I don't want to say the same, but I think he had a lot of influence. And I think the kind of shows in the film with a lot of the stuff that happens being... what's some of the stuff that can come up at the top of my head? One is at the start of the film where Andrew Garfield's acting his little heart out being Spider-Man, but in the process of that, he's causing mass casualties as Rhino kills everyone in his wake, like driving over police cars, and Peter's just like, haha, how you doing? I'm gonna pull your underwear down. And I'm like, bro, what the fuck? and then after that, it's like his parents were like super spies, and he's got like a super spy basement or whatever in a train subway thing that just gets cut out, and Gwen's going to uni in London, but oh no, her neck's broken, so she's going into the grave instead. Like, I don't think there's a lot of stuff that really works that film.
So what were your thoughts of Avi Arad having a wee thank you at the end of No Way Home then?
Oh, right? Fucking shit. He there's nothing to like Mark Webb and Sam Raimi in the film. There's no like special thanks to them, but Avi Arad gets a whole credit. It's like, thank you, Avi Arad. Just like, suck him off, why don't you? Like, what's the point?
Thank you, Avi, for fucking this up so much. We had to fix it in this.
Yeah.
Even though we still had to use Lizard for some reason.
Well, who else would they have used?
Rhino? I don't know.
Rhino? So
it's just as bad, but you know. I didn't even bother with Lizard. They were just like, Doctor Strange turned up all like beaten to fuck and just went, oh, I got that guy. There he is.
It's just like, I've caught him in. I don't really know what to say about the Mark Webb films. I do enjoy Andrew Garfield, and his performance in No Way Home almost makes me want to see an amazing Spider-Man 3. Not as much as I want to see Spider-Man 4, but I still want to see him in other stuff. Maybe they can make his Peter Parker work in the Venomverse. Mm-hmm. But then again, I'm not too sure on the Venomverse either. So,
yeah, that was kind of my compromise in my brain was going, I think it'll get too muddled if we have another Spider-Man floating about. It's like Batman.
Yeah,
there's too many Batmans, so let's just like have one Batman. But that's a whole other discussion. But yeah, so I would take it if he's a bit part in the Venom ones, even though I don't really I don't care to watch the Venom ones. Yeah. I might if Andrew Garfield turns up, because
I just think like I think Andrew deserves like another shot, like at being Spider-Man, or at least like hits. I like his version of the character, so I would like to see a bit more of that. But yeah, just the duology isn't great.
No, it's definitely not. So that's them out of the way, and then we'll just dive into the. Oh, we'll go to MCU, or do you want into the Spider-Verse? Do you want MCU all in one kind of block? Or?
Well, how long do you want me on for? Because if you want me to talk about Into the Spider-Verse, we could be here for 3 hours. I'm not gonna lie to you.
You know, we can do it. We'll do it into the Spider-Verse, and we'll go to MCU, and then we'll finish with Japanese Spider-Man, and we might have some, of course, questions. We'll go to the questions first. That's the best way.
Oh, okay, sick.
Because there is stuff about not MCU and not Into the Spider-Verse. So we've got Vic, the anime weeb on YouTube, which is a wonderful handle on Twitter. Oh, okay. Is The Amazing Spider-Man 2/Spider-Man 3 overhated, or is it just people saying it because of No Way Home?
I don't think it's like, I think they're fairly criticized to an extent. There are some people that would overhate on those films, specifically because they're going back and watching it from No Way Home and being like, what the fuck is this? And I'm like, but there's so much, specifically in Spider-Man 3, there's so many good points in that. And there's even good points in The Amazing Spider-Man 2, as much as I've just sat here for the past 15 minutes and gone, no, it's bad. But like there are good points, and I don't like hating on films in general, which is ironic given my disposition on YouTube. But like I do like looking at the more positives as well and being like, oh yeah, that worked there, but didn't work with the rest of the film. I do think they're a little bit overhated to an extent though. More so The Amazing Spider-Man 2. Because Spider-Man 3 kind of came in and been like, people will start to really like that now. So I'm like, good, your eyes are opening. You know exactly what great cinema is now.
Fair enough, that's fine. So we've got, oh no, that's just someone saying you're booked and busy, which you are, because you're on the Spider-Man tour of all these podcasts. If any podcaster wants to jump on and speak Spider-Man, I'm sure Alex will be very happy to.
I've got like, because I put my Gmail into my Twitter header now, and I got an email being like, you want to come on a podcast? And I'm like, sure. So I've got another one booked in for whenever.
There we go. See, all over the place. YouTube, wrestling, podcasts. You're gonna be everywhere. TikTok.
Popular guy.
Get the TikTok dances going and all that.
I feel like I'm hitting 24. I'm too old to be going on to TikTok these days.
Oh yeah, I go on to it and I look at the trends going, why? I don't understand this. And then I'll see some shit about Spider-Man and I'll be like, okay, I'm listening. I'll watch this a little bit longer. But yeah, so we've got Joel Starr. He's asked, how come Andrew Garfield has PTSD of clock towers? I think that's, I think we both know why.
I think that's a very self-explanatory answer.
That's fine. And Gosh Williams has asked, favorite Spider-Man moment?
Moment?
Yeah.
Oh, fuck me. That's like picking my favorite child. I don't know. I think there's two that come to mind. The first one is, oh no, there's more that come to mind. No! Okay. The one that comes to mind most of all is the train scene. I really like that. In Spider-Man 2. There's another one that I really like in Spider-Man 2 where it's just Peter talking to Aunt May, and it's Aunt May talking to him about what it means to be a superhero and explaining what they mean to regular people. And she's like, sometimes we need to be steady and give up the things we love just to do what's right and shit like that. I'm paraphrasing, but
No, I think that's word for word.
That's the quote, exactly. But I remember it really, really liking that. Is one of like my favorite kind of like Spider-Man moments. Like that's the definitive one that pops up in my head. But then Into the Spider-Verse with Miles like not getting his powers, but learning to master his powers, and that scene where he's just like upside down. Everyone will say it, but it's a beautiful, beautiful shot, and I love it a lot.
And that's fine. You've mentioned Into the Spider-Verse. We can just like slip nicely into that. So 2018, Into the Spider-Verse came out. It didn't really focus on, well, it kind of focused on Peter Parker, but mainly it was Miles Morales.
Yeah.
Which is a big deal, because this is the first time he would have been like in cinema.
He came about in like 2011 after the Ultimate Universe Peter Parker died, I'm pretty sure. I'm not too clued up on the Ultimate Comics. I'm sure someone is. So I'm pretty sure Peter dies in that universe and then Miles Morales comes around and he's like, oh my God, I've got Spider-Man powers now. So he's like, he becomes the definitive Spider-Man for that universe. So he was in the comics for a while. His popularity got really, really big until I'm pretty sure they brought him into the Spider-Verse. And he was the main focus of that. And I said Spider-Man 1 was one of the best origin stories. That Into the Spider-Verse is also fucking up there because that it's such a good telling of Miles' story and it fixed any problems that he had in the comics at the time.
It was one of those, I didn't know much. I knew the name. That was about it. I don't read the comics. Shock horror to anyone. That's why I didn't know Age of Venom was that thing till 2011. But yeah, so I watched the films. I watched the cartoons. That's pretty much it. That's my Spider-Man-ing. And yeah, seeing this, heard the name, I was watching it going, this is just a beautiful movie. It's a superhero film, but it's just a beautifully made film as well.
I think that's quite telling if you can just sit there and be like, just not say it's a good superhero film, it's just a good film.
Mm-hmm.
That sounds super fucking pretentious, but it's like, if you can just sit there and kind of like not think that this is another Marvel film or this is another DC film and just go, this is a great film. There's only a few films that really do that. I think like The Dark Knight, just The Dark Knight.
Yeah.
Into the Spider-Verse, Spider-Man 2 for me, maybe for other people it'll just be come across as another Spider-Man, as another superhero film. But for me, that's a great movie. There's probably other ones that I'm missing off the top of my head. Venom is cinematic genius at its finest. Specifically for the top class writing of Like a Turd in the Wind. Honestly, I wept tears of joy when I heard that. I think Into the Spider-Verse is just a very, very well-made and clearly a lot of passion has went into that film.
So much so that we're getting two in 2020, well, one, another one 2022, which is this year. Sorry.
Yeah, exactly.
It's January. Sorry, it's still 11 days into the new year as of recording and I've forgotten the year already. So we're getting Across the Spider-Verse Part 1 and Across the Spider-Verse Part 2 in 2023. What are your
with
hopes?
What looks to have the first, with the, oh, hello, sorry. Which looks to have the first, like, okay, it was in Into the Spider-Verse in the post-credit scene, but which looks to have Spider-Man 2099, Miguel O'Hara in it for like a kind of like defensive role in a big movie that isn't like a game or anything like that. So I'm looking forward to seeing what they do with him because he's a very different kind of Spider-Man. He's a massive, like, smug dickhead, but he's in the best way possible.
I'd like to say, I've only ever seen, like, it looks like a cool-ass suit. That's pretty much all I know of 2099, is just, it's an amazing-looking suit.
I think everyone looks at the suit and goes, oh my God, it's so sexy, and then that's about it.
Yeah, so that's your kind of hopes. You're going to see that. Is there anything that are you thinking of maybe a tie-in with any multiverse stuff? Do you think we'll
get tied
into any MCU property or Sony property?
As much as I do like some of the multiverse stuff, I like a film to have its own identity as well. Mm. So if they go across the multiverse, maybe don't include the MCU Spider-Man or like the Andrew Garfield Spider-Man or the Tobey Maguire-verse or whatever you want. Have like, make your own like unique universes, like go to L.A. Noire's universe and like see some of the villains from there because they've got some really fucked up versions. Like L.A. Noire's universe has a Vulture that like has a cannibalistic freak show version of Vulture that ate Uncle Ben. That's that Peter Parker's origin story in the Noir universe. Or go to 2099's universe, or go to like maybe the Ultimate Universe with like, or maybe go to a universe that has Peter Parker where he's like fully bonded with the symbiote or something like that. Maybe not that because you need to establish that before you do it, but I don't know, just have like something like that. Maybe introduce Madam Web.
Yeah. I mean, so pretty much create a universe in itself, a multiverse in itself without having to rely on the live action stuff.
And I think the first Into the Spider-Verse film did that really well without them to rely on any of the other films. So I think they can do that here as well.
I think that's the beauty of things like Spider-Man and again like Batman, bringing that weirdness up again. But these characters are now so ingrained in pop culture. You don't need to origin every single time you introduce them again. If you do a Batman film, no doubt with this one with Robert Pattinson. I listen too much. What's it called? Every time I hear his name, I just like Rob at Bat and Bat, and it's really fucking annoying me now because it's all I've got in my head. But so Robert Pattinson. Robert Pattinson. So with this one, no doubt they'll do some grungy fucking origin story with it, but you don't need to. It's Batman. Everyone knows what Batman is at this point.
Did you see the reveal for the Riddler's costume that came out?
I've seen a picture of it. It's
a departure from.
It's a big green bin bag. That's what it is.
It's a weird departure. Like I kind of like it because it's reminiscent of the Zodiac Killer, and I think that's what they're going for. But I want to see that green suit pop up where it's like, I want to see that kind of like flamboyant Riddler.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe not as flamboyant as the Jim Carrey version. And you're not getting me to talk about Batman and Robin. We're not a chance. But yeah, maybe
Batman
something.
And Robin. Batman and Robin then. So we'll just do that as part three.
Part four? Fucking hell.
I skipped you part three there. Part three will be Batman. Oh God, that would be just a travesty for everyone's ears. Us having to speak about Batman for, and Batman and Robin particularly, and anything with Mr. Freeze. Although 10 out of 10 for puns.
Indeed.
Where are we? Are we still in Into the Spider-Verse? I think we are.
I will sum up Into the Spider-Verse because I could say so many things about it, but I'll just say very good film. Only went at 25 frames per second though, so obviously 1 out of 10.
Okay, that's fine. I'll look at you and go, yeah, absolutely. As someone whose whole tech thing is hoping that my microphone works.
I'm hoping someone will get that.
There you go. That's fine. If you did get it, comment below. There you go. Like, subscribe while you're at it. We'll go into. You know what? We're not going to do MCU yet. We're going to go Japanese Spider-Man because I am intrigued. That's the word. Intrigued about Japanese Spider-Man. I've seen some clips. If I'm right, I saw a gun. What is Japanese Spider-Man to you? And what is Japanese Spider-Man?
It has been a while since I have seen any of the source material of Japanese Spider-Man. But I will always remember his transformation scene into Spider-Man. And by that, I mean, I'm pretty sure he is like, I think, something to do with aliens this time. I can't really remember. But anyway, he becomes Spider-Man through convoluted means that aren't I've gotten bit by a spider. And then he gets a watch that he presses. And then the Spider-Man suit jumps out. And then it just cuts to him in the Spider-Man suit. And it's like, he's like, duh, 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 like the most generic, like karate, whatever you fucking want to say. And then he's like, he's got a Megazord, I'm pretty sure.
Of course he has, it's Japan.
I'm pretty sure, like the best way I can sum it up is Power Rangers, but Spider-Man.
You've sold me on it.
I'm about to say, if that doesn't sell the film to you, the series to you, I don't know what will.
I want to see the spider zord now.
I've seen so much like shit with it. It's all kind of just melded into one. I'm pretty sure there's a scene where he just gets a gun and guns down people. That makes it sound a lot more dark than what it is. But I'm pretty sure. But like, I can't remember what it is because I've used it as a meme and that's about it.
Is it the same series that has him with the spanner and a wrench and he's just like.
Oh, it's just like banging. I think it might be. I'm not too sure because that might be the like 80s live action one or something like that.
Okay. So
it might not even be like I'm going off the top of my head here. If I'm getting shit wrong, but I'm going to get corrected. So
it's fine. I would type it, but I've already established that I won't punch myself when I hear typing, myself typing on podcasts. So we'll just have to leave that as a mystery for the future and people can correct us.
I'll like message you after the podcast being like, this is what it is.
I don't know what to do. Do I put post credit? Just go, this is what it is. Listen to the end. Right, so that was Japanese Spider-Man. Let's get into the MCU then. So we won't go through every film Tom Holland's in because that would be 6 of them. And even though Endgame, it was only in the last like 5 minutes. But.
Yeah, I would argue like Civil War, Infinity War, and Endgame. While they feature him, they're not particularly Spider-Man films. So
But we'll like go into Civil War a little bit because this is our first time we're seeing Tom Holland as Spider-Man. I love Tom Holland's portrayal of Spider-Man, I will say that. But I will put in something I don't like, which is something I don't often say about Spider-Man in general. The suit's too smooth.
Yeah, because they like that's because they like paint over it with a lot of CGI, and it looks so unrealistic.
But like the Black Panther suit looks like it's like a suit.
Yeah, yeah. But like,
but Spider-Man doesn't.
Because I'm pretty sure in like test footage, he had like raised webbing and stuff like that. But like, no, that's too similar to the previous film. So they gave him this weird kind of like streamlines. I still like it to an extent, but it looks too glossy, too clean. If you know what
yeah.
I mean.
Yeah. It's not often I say anything bad about these films because it's just like MCU films are like crack to me. I'll just watch them anyway. Except Eternals. I'll watch that once
because I did a tier list of the MCU films and I got slated. So let's not go into that.
Where was Eternals in your list? Out of curiosity.
I did it up until Far From Home.
Right. Okay.
So it was like S A B C D and that was about it.
Well, I think I did see this list and I didn't comment because I thought, why put that negativity into the world?
I was like, I thought it was like, I thought everyone liked Iron Man 3. Apparently not.
I liked it.
Yeah, same.
It's not very high on my list because everything else is better, but I liked it.
Yeah, but then I got like, people like quote tweeting me being like, Iron Man 3 deserves to be in a D tier all the time. Like, what the fuck has Iron Man 3 done?
I liked it. It was fine. It wasn't an Iron Man film. It was a Tony Stark film, but you know.
But like, is that not like you can say the same thing for Spider-Man 2. It was a Peter Parker film.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, like you say, Infinity War is not an Avengers film. It's a Thanos film. That's what it is. It's a film by Thanos.
I would fully agree with that, actually.
So yeah, so I mean, like when you go in, if you watch it and you think, oh, that's quite a good film. And then but if you think about it, it isn't an Iron Man film. Anyway, this is
we're getting so so sidetracked.
I know, because yeah, I liked it. That's what I'll say if anyone asks.
I have the little ironmonger here, so if everyone talk about it, I've got that. That's
part four. That's
not ironmonger, that's the Mark One suit they took out of the cave. I should preference that because I did
maybe
not
scraps. So that's fine. So part three is Batman, part four
I have a Russian Batman if you ever want that. This is from Superman Red Sun. What else do I have here? Sorry, now I'm just going for my pops. I have Exodia if you ever
wow, that's like a fair bit of kit.
It's a massive one. It sits on my desk. What else? I have the Punisher. Where do I go on that?
That's cool, but I mean, it'd have to be the Thomas Jane one, you know, with Kevin Nash, just to get the wrestling content in.
Oh my god, yes, please. We'll do a watch along.
Oh god, that sounds like the best and B, the worst idea in the world. I'll put that in there somewhere. We'll get Frank as well. We'll just all
get Frank. Yeah, okay.
He's paid for Zoom, I'm sure. He can pay for it. And my pops are wrestling. I've got the Lucha ones, which everyone slates, but I love them because it's wrestling and Marvel put together. So, you know.
I think I've got one of them. I might have the Iron Man. Anyway, fucking the MCU Spider-Man before we get sidetracked again.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And, you know, it is a school night, as I used to say back in my youth. We're recording here. So, yeah, Civil War was the first time you saw him. Glossy suit, but, you know, it's Spider-Man. Cool. Yeah.
I think him in the film was very like, seeing him in that film made me really enthusiastic to see the other films. I think his portrayal in Civil War, or at least his like 50 minutes, is the best part of Civil War. Yeah. Or one of the best parts. I think it's one of the better portrayals of Spider-Man in the MCU, because I'm not the biggest fan. I like Homecoming. Don't really like Far From Home, and then No Way Home I'm a big fan of, but we'll get obviously into the individuals of why.
Let's dive into Homecoming then, because that's the first one. So this is our first full action, feature length Tom Holland portrayal as Spider-Man. I loved it, but you know,
I really liked MCU. I genuinely really liked it. Like, I'm pretty sure in my Marvel tier list, that's the definitive ranking that everyone has to obey. I'm pretty sure I put in like A tier because I was like, I was really really happy with the film. It's not like again, I think Michael Keaton as Vulture is a very, very good casting, and I really enjoyed seeing his dynamic, and then seeing Tom's whole dynamic of being like, you don't need to start tech, you are Spider-Man, and like his whole thing when he's like lifting the rubble at the end of the film because Vulture drops like a house on this 15-year-old kid, and he's like, haha, you're going to die, and then he fucks off. And then Tom's like lifting up obviously all this rubble, and he's like, come on, Spider-Man, you can do this. I am Spider-Man. And it's like really good shot of him seeing his mask and in the puddle and then half of his face. And like, yeah, I really liked it. I thought it was a really fun film that I really enjoyed. Forgot I was gonna say that. And also his kind of whole thing was like, he doesn't need the suit. And then at the end of the film, Tony's like, here's the Iron Spider suit. And he's like, no, I don't need it. So he like, he just leaves without it. And he's like, it's kind of like him becoming his own man, his own hero. And then in Infinity War, he just gets the suit.
I liked a bit in Infinity War. It was like, as soon as you saw his arm and the hair stand up and end, the old Peter Tingle, which I'm not a fan of that being a thing. I like
Spidey sense.
But you know, we'll persevere with Peter Tingle for a bit. But no, as soon as you saw that, I was like, oh fuck, shit's going down. Spider-Man is here. And then of course he's kind of relegated for most of the film as just like the little boy who makes the quips and that, which, you know, it's in the larger universe of the things, it's fine.
I think it works, but I'm used to like seeing Peter be a more like integral like part of the, not integral part, but like being more than just quips, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. Like he's actually got a big brain.
Yeah, I mean, you can make webbing and all that kind of stuff. Yeah,
exactly.
I mean, you've got to be kind of smart to do that.
He's a smart kid.
So I couldn't do that. Yeah, like I'm Spider-Man, that's why. Maybe less of a Spider-Man, more of like, no, I don't want to imagine myself Spider-Man. It'd be worse than that. No, the you'll know, the gif of J. Jonah Jameson.
Yeah, as Spider-Man. I was about to say that would be me a lot of the time. Like I've seen like a mask on Etsy that's like a replica of the Sam Raimi mask. And I'm like, do I or do I not buy it? Because I've got some expendable funds that I could use to buy this replica of Spider-Man mask. And I looked at the price and it's like nearly £300. And I'm like, add to cart.
But you're a YouTuber now. This is what YouTubers buy. This is influencer purchases.
Stop! No! No!
I remember I bought Amazing Spider-Man 2 on Blu-ray for my sins because it came with a Spider-Man mask. And clearly it was for a child, but I was fucking buying that mask. I don't have it anymore, thankfully, because when I put it on, I might have a photo of it somewhere. I'll try and find it, but it's not good. It was not a wise purchase. The Blu-ray and the mask, but what was next? Far from Home. That's not your favorite. I'm saying it's not your favorite of the trilogy.
It's not really. I think it's...
Is it too Iron Man-y?
Yeah, a little bit. I think it, like, I hate the kind of Iron Boy Jr. comparison, but that's where it came from, and I think it's very apt for this film, because one, I hate the constant changing of all the suits, because he's in the... He starts in the Iron Spider suit, does he start in?
He has it, so yeah, must do.
And then he goes back to the original suit, then he's in the Night Prowler suit, which is just, I don't know why he gets given that, besides some lazy plot writing or whatever. And then he gets his own suit, which he makes, and then the whole film's like, you're not Tony Stark, but then it's like a lot of it's like suggesting that he is the next Tony Stark and he has to live up to that because it's like his scene. I just don't know. I think in the first film itself, there's really cool dynamic where Peter was his own man and he wasn't Tony Stark and he wasn't Iron Man, he was Spider-Man. And then I feel like Marvel just had their cake and wanted to eat it too, or whatever the fucking expression is for that, and they just gave him like all the kind of like Tony Stark-esque shit in it, and I was like, I don't really like it.
Yeah, I can see it. I mean, again, I love the films for what they are, so I'll try and find some negativity.
I think applying big clever man logic to a Marvel film might not be the best idea a lot of the time, but
yeah, that's possibly it. But when you think about all the suits, it's just because, you know, money,
toys,
like all those Funko Pops.
Yeah,
that's it. We see all these things like in No Way Home, where it showed like his gold and black suit, and people are going, oh, it could be this, it could be that. No, it's just his suit inside out.
Yeah, it's a suit inside
spoilers,
out.
Spoilers, people. That's what it is.
If you're this far in,
yeah, if you're this far. Yeah, if you're what's it about an hour and 20 we've been chatting about, probably an hour has been
about
Spider-Man.
That, yeah.
Yeah, if you're at this point never seen a Spider-Man film, what the fuck are you doing here? Just, you know, there's no more wrestling.
You're
this
watching a podcast of Alex Webb, for fuck's sake. My name is in the title.
Exactly. I mean, I'm going to put into the Webb-verse.
Oh my god, see, exactly.
A Spider-Man film review thing, not a film review. We're just touching on things.
These are not reviews. This is us rambling about Spider-Man for 45 minutes.
Yeah, pretty much. So yeah, Far From Home. Mysterio was the baddie in that one. I liked it.
I liked
but it was like you're saying, it is really it was an Iron Lad film kind of thing. Yeah, it was like he does Iron Man stuff and all that kind of thing. But you know, it was fine. It was a nice inclusion in the MCU multiverse. I'm trying to remember where I put it in my weird tier list, which I'm going to say, and you're going to just be aghast at how high it is. Where is it? Let's see. Nope, that's my shopping list. That's not going to be very useful. It is six. It's six in my tier list.
Six?
Six, yeah. Which I may regret.
I can't remember where I put it. I think it was D tier, I want to say, for me.
Oh, yeah, we're a wild difference between the two then.
Oh, no, not D tier, because D tier was for the Dark World and Incredible Hulk, so not that bad.
Oh, yeah, okay, right, okay, yeah, that's Thor, Dark World, Incredible Hulk. Eternals is 30th on my list. That's how fucking shit I thought that film was.
I haven't seen it, and I don't plan on watching it.
You know what? People like it. It's supposed to be a beautiful film, and I'm sure it is, but I'm there to switch off for 2 hours and see superheroes at each other for a bit. That's all I want. That's what I'm here for. I don't want nuance. Just give me some fucking big superheroes CGI.
Character development? Who needs that?
Exactly. Who cares? He has a big shield. Sweet. I'm in. That's all I need. Speaking of spendable income, that's what's in my downstairs lobby. I've got a Captain America shield on the wall. That was like the one we were decorating. I was like, I'm just going to put it there. And if you like it, we'll leave it there. And it just has not left that position.
There's obviously that Spider-Man mask I want to buy, but I also want to buy, you know, Star-Lord's helmet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I've seen like a replica model of that for like fucking 600. I'm like, I'm tempted.
I know. Every time I look at my Mjolnir in the background here, I keep wanting to get a Stormbreaker as well, just because, you know, got to complete the set. I have both so I can grow my beard out more and get a blonde wig and just be Fat Thor for Halloween. That's the
fair
dream
enough. You know, fair enough.
Joggers, a cardigan. It's the most comfortable suit ever. Speaking of suits, right, before we get No Way Home, this is a amazing segue, which I don't have prepared. Evan Young asked, Spider-Man.
We said it so much, it's lost all meaning.
We've lost it, that's it. He's just asked, a Spider-Man suit tier list would be appreciated. So obviously you're not going to put in all of them because
there's,
you know,
so many though.
So let's say a top five of your particular favorites. Could be cartoon, comic, live action, whatever. Say five of your favorites.
Number one is the Ben Reilly Scarlet Spider suit. You know, the really 90s one with the blue hoodie.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
That's like my favorite suit. It's impractical as shit, because I'm pretty sure in the comics there's the first time he encounters Venom, Venom just grabs the hood and tries to strangle him with it. But I love that suit because it's so fucking cool to me. Okay, so I've went number one. Let's go to five to two then. Off the top of my head, number five would be the Superior Spider-Man suit, which is when Dr. Octopus took over Peter Parker for a year. Don't know if you've heard about that, but Dr. Octopus, he put his mind into Peter Parker, and then he was Peter Parker, and he got into a relationship with a little woman, and he also, it's the best way I can sum it up.
I think I need clarification on little woman. That's... Just
what's the like politically correct?
Oh, okay, I'm with you now. That's fine. Yeah. Okay, right, carry on.
Yeah, I didn't know what to say, Billy.
That's fine. I didn't know. I thought a child. Are you talking about a child? But no. I've got you now. I'm with it.
Okay. So he does that, which is kind of creepy because she thinks it's this handsome Peter Parker, but really it's Dr. Octopus, but in his body. He also makes Parker Industries, which is this big industries where he makes tech, so basically the whole point is he's the Superior Spider-Man, he's better than Peter Parker, but spoiler alert, at the end of the story Peter gets his body back, and funnily enough Dr. Octopus wasn't a better Peter Parker. But that suit's really cool. That was a long-winded explanation for that, but the suit's really cool. Number four, let's say the Spider-Man PS4 suit.
The white.
With the white symbol, right.
Yeah, okay.
Number two, number three even would be the Sam Raimi suit. It's a number two and number two and three are like toss-ups. They could be either or. But number three would be the Sam Raimi suit. And then number two would be the black suit.
Oh, just die all black or the symbiote.
The symbiote suit.
Cool. Fine. When I heard black, I thought of Spider-Man Noir. Like, you know.
I mean, I like Spider-Man Noir, but not as much as like the symbiote suit because it looks cool.
Fine. There you go, Evan. There's the top five best ones, and because it's Alex saying it, that is it. That's canon. That is the best five suits.
It's canon.
It's canon. That's it. That's what the kids say, isn't it? With these things. We've also got Ian Ambrose. This is kind of just the last question, so I'm just throwing it in there. He's asked, who is the best Spider-Man and why is it Miles Morales?
I got really worried when you said Ian asked a question because I was like, I don't know what he could have possibly said.
It was a nice question.
Okay, good. I really like Miles Morales, so I'm not going to disagree with him. But it is Tobey Maguire, but we'll pass that up and like Ian.
So here we are then, this is the main event, we're into No Way Home. Of course, like you say, like I've said throughout this, you've done a bit more of an in-depth, like proper chat about this film with Frank Mandolini from Last Minute Wrestling Podcast.
I have indeed.
So check that out, people, obviously after you've listened to the end of this, because, you know, I need the hits. So, yeah. Anyway, so No Way Home, the rumours were rife that Toby and Andrew were appearing.
There was so much shit. So much shit going about that film.
I really like Tick, Tick, Boom, if Andrew Garfield listened to this, even though I doubt it. But, you know, I enjoyed Tick, Tick, Boom. It's just a shame that you had to spend all of the press doing, are you in Spider-Man? Are you in Spider-Man?
I watched Tick, Tick, Boom, and I really enjoyed it, especially the musical numbers. I'm not going to sing, but I did enjoy a lot of the music, especially hearing that Andrew didn't know how to sing beforehand, and he learned how to sing, and it was this really cool thing. Also, he spent like so much of the film like talking about how it was like a tribute to his mum and stuff like that. But then every fucking interviewer was like, "So, you in No Way Home, Andrew?" And he's like sitting there with Kevin Feige in the background, having a sniper rifle on his head. Like saying like, no, of course not, I'm not the werewolf, guys, sweating profusely. And then eventually it turns out, spoiler alert, he's in the film.
It's like, yeah, it's after like maybe twice, three times maybe, if he's not going to answer, I don't know, fucking Joe Blogs from entertainment, whatever, comicbook.com. It's not going to turn out and go, guys, guess what? I'm Spider-Man.
You'd think like after the first like couple of interviews when people were like, oh, are you in this film? And he's like, no, people get the hint they can't say anything. He's got a fucking disclosure. He's got 17 snipers on him at all times. Kevin Feige probably has his dog locked up somewhere. Like, he can't say anything.
Exactly. Tick, Tick, Boom is also the sound it'll make if he revealed who's in Spider-Man. But yeah, so it was a shame for him, but fuck me, I was amazing. Seeing him appear.
I it's the first time I've been, because I went with Ryan, who was featured in my wrestling reactions video. We're two massive Spider-Man nerds. So we were going down the car, we're talking about all the shit, and he looked at me and was like, bro, I'm jealous of us right now, because we're not gonna have the same feeling after we see the film. We went and seen the film, and we were like speculating what was gonna happen. My thought process was Norman Osborn was going to kill a loved one of Peter's, specifically sexy Aunt May. Spoiler alert, I was correct. Sitting there watching the film, the anticipation building to the point of seeing all these, like, I heard the Octavius theme kick in when Big Doc Ock pops up. I grabbed Ryan, he grabbed me, we looked at each other. We're like, oh my god, it's happening. Even though we've seen it in the trailers, Norman pops up, we do it again. Lizard, we do it again. Up until the point where Aunt May dies and Peter's at his lowest point, which is where I think the film kind of kicks up a gear. The first half, well, so-so. And then after when sexy Aunt May dies, that's when it kicks up into high gear and it becomes a very, 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 very good film. And sorry, Frank, but it's Spider-Man 3, as much as I enjoy that cinematic masterpiece, it isn't as good as No Way Home.
It's the only time I've both been like when it happened and everyone in the cinema went, I went, fair enough, but shut the fuck up. I want to hear the rest of this film. So you can have your reaction.
Then Andrew popped up. So he popped up. No one really reacted because we were all kind of like, we didn't know what to say. And he takes his mask off. And it's the first time I've ever been in the theater and heard people clap and go, yeah. And I'm like, oh my God. Yeah. And then Toby pops up and I fucking
melted.
I melted into my seat. I said in a video that if I so much as hear the Danny Elfman theme, I would ascend to another plane of reality, sit and cry, or get incredibly horny. And fuck me, I got all three. it was very good seeing him for the first time in ages, and it was a very good representation of the way those characters were in their respective films. I don't think it like ruined how those characters were portrayed in those films. I think it encapsulated them really well. And I think it gave some redemption to Andrew Spider-Man specifically, because that film made me love him. And I'm like, oh my God, I love you, Andrew Garfield. And that full head of hair that I wish I had.
I know. Yeah. That's everyone. Yeah. That floppy hair look. I don't know if I like it or not, but I think I'm just jealous of it at this point. Yeah. Just seeing it. Just
going, I'm jealous that he's nearly 40 and looks that good.
He's what?
He's like, he was 29 when Amazing Spider-Man came out. So I'm 10 years later. He's like, I think he's 38, 39.
I look older than him. That's disgusting. I'm 31. That's exact same age as Margot Robbie. Born the same day, 2nd of July.
Fair enough.
The difference is
both very attractive human beings.
Oh, thank you very much.
No problem.
You're wrong, but thank you very much. I know Margot's an ugger. Right, so that's very not true. But anyway, that's the thing about this film was, you know, I think, I don't know if it'll hold up eventually with everything else that comes about, but that feeling, that moment of seeing Andrew...
Very much like an Endgame film where it feels like a lot of stuff coming together for one big fantastical film. I did really enjoy it. Maybe I won't like it as much on rewatches, but the one thing I will love are some of the moments in it with like Toby stopping Tom throwing the glider into Norman. That's like an all-time Spider-Man moment for me. Or Dr. Octopus and Tobey Maguire reuniting for the first time. Or Andrew saving MJ and getting that redemption, or the last like 15 minutes of the film where Tom gets his shitty apartment, no one remembers him, he puts on that his own homemade suit, he jumps out, he's his own Spider-Man, he doesn't have anyone, he's his own superhero, and I've never felt so enthusiastic about Spider-Man films since like ever.
That's also one of the things you didn't need to watch. Spider-Man 1-3 and then Spider-Man 1 and 2 to get the moments, I don't think.
Yeah, of course.
Because again, I'm throwing Kelly under the bus with all this stuff, but she hadn't seen these. She couldn't get through Amazing Spider-Man 1, so she wasn't going to get through 2 because, you know, I wasn't going to force that on her. I think that would be a crime. But she was like, I got it when Garfield, Andrew's Spider-Man saved MJ. It's like, I got that that's a massive moment for him.
He did, because he specifically said at the start of like when he comes in, Toby was like talking about his Uncle Ben dying, and Andrew was talking about Gwen dying, and then you can see it tears him up inside and how hurt and upset he is that he couldn't save her. And that also plays into the end of the film where he catches her, and it's kind of very evident what the point is. You don't need to see the source material, it helps obviously, but you don't need to see it to get it.
Yeah, and of course, I liked that they did have little nods and also like little needles at the past films, like with going through Andrew's not so stellar list of villains, and then of course.
Oh no! But there's such a cute moment when Toby just turns around and is like, it's like, because like Andrew's like, I'm lame, and then Toby's like, the fuck did you just say to me?
You're amazing.
You're amazing. You're amazing. I'm like, oh, bro, my heart. And then talks about Toby ejaculating web fluid, which is great.
That was my next point. Yeah, it was just like there was it felt right that it was just a little bit too long discussing it. But it felt it had to be that awkward eventually.
It would have been weird of them not to do it down that route, because everyone thinks it. Like, how do you, like, I enjoy it, and I think it makes sense for that whole universe. But at the same time, I've always like wondered, like, how does he store it? How does it feel coming out of him? How does he do it when he's wearing a suit? Like, does he cut little holes in his suit for the webs to shoot out?
Yeah. Or is it like sharp enough that it goes through his suit and then he just maybe. A fucking tie his suit?
Then sometimes he's like firing like web balls. So I'm like, how do you form that in your wrist?
There's more questions than answers coming out of this. But no, but like, if he gets too excited, does it have to be like that? Because of course, clearly, because in the first one, he tried to do different ways.
But like, it's fly, web, like, fly. It's like pressing that bit down your palm. So surely he could just go like that.
Thought of him just going.
It takes a lot of impact out of the scenes where he's just going.
I bet he clapped for MJ. But surely if he went like that, it would just go. You know, so there's
secrets just out there.
Just sitting in the theater while she's warbling her fucking song, and it's streamers. Yeah, it's streamers.
It's just like people are throwing roses, and he just goes, all the fucking webs go across the stage.
There you go, Spider-Man 4. There's your one, Sam. Once you've done Multiverse of Madness, there's your Spider-Man 4 sort of deal. Just be a. The word I've got my head spooging. I don't want to. I've used it now. Spooging web.
That's very much an OSW quote.
I know. It's yeah. That's.
I might get my own spooge T-shirt one day.
Well, the AJ Styles one or the particular?
AJ. Well, I like the AJ Styles one, but I also like the Sin Cara Dick one.
That one, and I like Val Venus's one, but AJ Styles is particularly great because he's wearing it in the catalog, and he looks. Like he's like, I know, guys.
Who thought that was a good idea? Like, you can say a lot about that for late TNA, but like, who did think that was a good idea?
It's like, I know the guy. I guarantee two things in this life, guys: that the world's flat and this T-shirt's awful. this is two things.
One of those is not guaranteed, but we won't talk about the T-shirt anymore.
How the fuck do we get to wrestling chat again? This is disgraceful. How the fuck do we do this? Anyway, we didn't even mention Bonesaw, but you know, that's.
Oh my god, Bonesaw! Yeah,
we're way past it. If they were doing the Bonesaw McGraw thing again, which wrestler would you want in there?
Oh, this is a question I have not ever contemplated. I think you can't do Bonesaw again, so you have to do like a Bonesaw son.
All right, Bonesaw McGraw Jr. Got it.
Yeah, because it'd be wrong to just recast big old Randy Savage. So I think like you'd have to do like a Bonesaw Junior, and I don't know, maybe I don't think the only one that came to mind straight off the bat would be like Seth Rollins because of like the long hair, but I'm like I don't think he's got the kind of oomph in his voice to do that.
We want a big roidy guy, Brian Cage maybe.
Brian Cage maybe Drew.
I thought Cody Rhodes for a second because you know he appears everywhere.
I think Drew would be a good shout because he's just got that kind of like nailed voice and whatever. So I think, and he's huge guy, so I think that'd be decent.
There we go. That's fine. So Drew, of course, you're listening to this as well. You've gathered everyone. There you go. Just here you go. Bonesaw McGraw Jr. Drew McIntyre. You know what? I can see it. That's it. I'm all in. I'm investing in this. Add that to your pitch when you're
when I'm pitching what the remake of Spider-Man 3.
Just everything. Okay. I've got a big book of Spider-Man here. This is your next 12 films. I've got it now. So, Bonesaw McGraw is the villain for the fourth one.
Bro, how the fuck did we get onto this? Like, I'm sitting here like thinking we were on about talking about No Way Home and a really emotional moment of Andrew Garfield. Now we're talking about recasting Bonesaw.
This is the podcast. It's four seasons in and it's still nowhere, like, still not. Any structure or purpose. The fact that I've written down the names of the films in order is way better than I've ever done anything
fair,
else.
Fair enough.
No Way Home. How often did you cry during it? Because I know you did cry because you did reveal that with Frank.
I did. I shed a tear at two moments. The first one was when I seen Toby again, because it's been so long and both me and Ryan grabbed each other and I think I was just like, oh my god. I was like, it wasn't like I was actively crying, but it was like, I welled up a little bit. Nothing wrong with crying, but I welled up a little bit. And then the bit where I was like, oh, fuck, I'm going to go, was when Toby and Dr. Octopus speak for the first time. And it's like, specifically for the one line where Toby's like, Dr. Octopus says, how are you doing? Peter, dear boy, how are you doing? Whatever he says. And then Peter just looks at him and is like, trying to do better, which is a direct callback to the first time they met in Spider-Man 2. I just think it's such a good scene, and it brought so many memories, and I welled up. And then maybe I nearly cried when Toby, I thought Toby had died, but then that was more out of anger than anything else.
Oh, you bastards, why? I did shed a tear when May died, not because sexy Aunt May died, but mainly because they said the thing. There was like,
it did.
Great
it did
power. And I was like, it's saying the thing it says.
And I think it completely works with that Spider-Man. Like, you don't need to just shoehorn in Uncle Ben if you haven't mentioned him throughout the other films. So yeah, Aunt May being the one that says it, completely fine with that. I just wish she was maybe built up a little bit more in previous films than just being the comic relief of Happy.
I don't know where you're going. I thought you were about to say, I wish she was a bit hotter. But yeah.
No. contrary to what I've said in this podcast, I don't think like Aunt May should be hot to any extent. I just think a lot of people associate it with that version of Aunt May.
Yeah, I mean, Mary Steenburgen, has Mary Steenburgen played Amazing Spider-Man Aunt May? She's a very handsome woman, and I can't remember the name of the actress who played Raimi ones.
I should, but neither can I. But she was a great Aunt May too.
Another handsome. I'm sure she was a great gal in her day. So, No Way Home, crying. It was a very emotional time for everyone, and the fact that people are trying to think that are trying to say, yeah, give Andrew and Toby another Spider-Man film is testament to how their characters were treated.
And I think with the amount of fan support for those characters, I think Sony will just see dollar signs and do something with those characters. Maybe Toby will show up in Multiverse of Madness. Maybe Andrew will show up in the Venomverse. Who knows? The future, the possibilities are endless, though, and I'm looking forward to whatever they do with Spider-Man next.
I think the next thing's, was they doing freshman year? They're doing, like, an animated thing?
Yeah, that's, like, of Tom before Civil War, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah. So I'm sure we'll see Aunt Ben, progressive. Uncle Ben's going to die again. That'll be
fantastic.
Yeah, can't wait.
I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah. So before we kind of close out the whole Spider-Man chat, when they did the opening of the multiverse that showed all these kind of figures coming through, of course, clearly you'd see Rhino and Kraven Hunter and all that kind of stuff. Was there any one silhouette that you saw in particular going, yes, that's who needs to be the next villain in the next film?
Kraven, actually. I really, really want to say it's quite dark for a lighthearted Disney film that doesn't show any blood. But I really, really want to see a version of Last Hunt. Kraven's Last Hunt is one of the best Spider-Man comics. I have it up on my bookshelf over there. I'm not going to get up because I'm just wearing shorts and I can't get my thighs on camera.
You have to pay for that. Back to the OnlyFans.
You have to pay a ticket to see me wrestle or pay a ticket to the OnlyFans.
Yeah.
But yeah, like Last Hunt is probably one of my favorite Spider-Man films. Spider-Man comics, I should say. And it's quite a dark one because Kraven effectively kills quote-unquote Spider-Man. He actually drugs him and buries him underground for 2 weeks, and Kraven takes on the mantle of Spider-Man, fighting Vermin, I'm pretty sure, which is a really obscure Spider-Man villain. And then he comes back, he realizes he's beaten his like top prey or something like that. I'm sure I'm butchering it, and I'm sure someone's going to correct me, but eventually it ends with Kraven killing himself because he's killed his like top prey he can find, and that's all Kraven views it as, is like it's a hunt. And I really want to see that kind of translated into the films. Maybe not so much as Kraven donning the mantle of Spider-Man and jumping about the place as Spider-Man, but something to that effect, where it's like Kraven wants to kill the biggest game he can find, and that being Spider-Man.
Oh, that's fine. I'm sure people will agree. I'm not a comic guy. I'm really going to have to start picking some up because I've read some Deadpool ones and I really enjoyed reading them. It's just getting, I like screens. So I might need to get there's an app, isn't there?
Comicsology or something like that?
That's the one. I might need to invest in that. And actually be able to not look like I'm so confused when people speak about comics and like Craven's Last Hunt, just going, I'm sure you're right. I'm just doing it. Yes, absolutely.
You can read Agent. You can read Agent Venom.
I could read Agent Venom. Venom. Fucking.
We've been doing this way too long, man.
I know. I think we have. It's for outside of the bubble. It's like 9 o'clock now. So I think we're going to wrap up. I think for again, like I say, school night. Well, enough. I mean, you're an influencer, even though you're trying not to be.
All right. In mentioning that, I have a little bit of advice for people that post YouTube videos, specifically people that run like wrestling channels, because I've noticed this. Promotions that have like put up matches and stuff like that, don't put it as for kids, as like made for kids, because that limits your, like, you can't comment on it, you can't play it in the mini player, you fuck up all your engagement. Just put it as not made for kids, and then you'll get a lot more people seeing it.
Well, advice to end the episode in. That's even better. So if you've gotten this far,
it just annoys me so much, because I'm like, I'm not naming names, but I watched some match. I watched like one of my old matches, and I scrolled, not my old matches, but something I did pre-pandemic, and I went down and I wasn't on the mini player and I couldn't comment on it, and I was like, why have you done this?
Oh, it's like, I mean, not as an influencer, because I'm not one of those, but as someone who just uses social media and I see wrestling companies put up like really badly written things, and I'm looking, going, just for fuck's sake, run it through.
There's that, and when I see MS Paint posters, that's my favorite one. As someone who came from that company in Dundee and seen some of the, and was advertised on some of the worst posters I've ever fucking seen.
Yeah, there's. I mean, I made some posters for Rock and Wrestle, and I mean, they weren't great, but I've seen worse by people that are probably getting paid to do it. But I know, actually, it's Dundee. No, they're not. But
No. It was free. It was free, of course.
Of course, yeah. Experience. You got to learn how to make posters, and then we've got some coppers for you at the end.
That's what I'm going to do now. Whenever someone wants me to wrestle for them, I'll be like, I'm going to pay you in exposure.
Exactly. You've got over 66,000 subscribers. You know.
68, Billy, get it right. Come on now.
I'm sorry. 70 by the time this goes out, I'm sure. And Kwaku will have to start writing, scrubbing out the notes every time he does the announcements.
I'm yet to get him to do the weighing in at the, because the last time we did it, I had like 800 and something. So I need to get him to do the now weighing in at 70,000 subscribers. That's fucking cool. I need to get him to do that. Anyway, I'm mumbling on for no particular reason.
That's cool. So we actually somehow ended this show on wrestling chat. I don't know how. It's amazing. We bookended it perfectly with Spider-Man between. Got to make sure to put Spider-Man in the episode title to get all the fucking hits.
Of course.
Anyway, so this has been an absolute blast. I didn't realize this amount of time had gone past, and I probably could speak about it longer, but you know, we're both fatiguing really fucking quickly at this point, where we can't even make out any words. So
I'm bad at the best of times, where I just start mumbling and shit like that. Like, I can't, like, as I'm doing right now, I'm stuttering so much, I'm like, Billy, we need to end it quickly.
I know. I'm just hoping that my microphone hasn't fucked up like last week's episode. I'm praying that I don't have to listen back to this, go, oh, for fuck's sake. It's just blah, 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 garbled.
Alex, we have to do this again.
I know.
Oh, okay.
Remember your opinion. Remember, there's a funny thing about OnlyFans. You'll love it. Anyway, so yeah, for people that want to find out more about you, I want to send you, want to give you shit about your tier list, and just any other things, where can people find you?
Twitter is AlexWeb101. Instagram is the same, I'm pretty sure. You can just type my name into YouTube. I'm the first thing that pops up. That's always a flex I love to do. Thank you for having me on.
No bother. Thanks again for being on.